Okay, so I've already said a few words about the Higgs boson, and we're a little bit late to start, so let me introduce Harvey Newman on the Caltech faculty, and he's one of the leaders of Caltech's CMS effort, and he's going to tell us today about the results from CMS using the 2010 and 2011 data for the Higgs search.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Mark, and I'm very happy to be here. This morning, as you know, there was a seminar at CERN to give an update on the latest results on the search for the Higgs. And I'll cover the CMS results, and if you ask me a question at the end, maybe I'll say a little bit about the ATLAS results also. So here's a little outline, the Caltech CMS group, how the LHC and CMS are doing, then the Higgs search update, and the outlook for 2012 and beyond. And to say the least, this is what I'm about to tell you is, well, as I said, it's an update, but it's certainly the opening of a new era of physics for everybody in our field. Okay, so I introduced some of the people in the group. In this large collaboration, our group, which I lead together with Maria Spiropoulou, includes about 15 physicists and several teams of engineers on critical technologies for the experiment and for the Hendry physics community at large. And as you'll see, the group's impact on the overall program is disproportionately large. And we're very happy about our contribution to this effort and to these results. Okay, so as Mark said a little bit, we have this standard model of the basic constituents of matter and the forces between them. And it encapsulates most of our knowledge of high energy physics so far, and it's remarkably successful. If it's true, then there is one missing element, which is the Higgs boson. But even if we find the Higgs boson, we'll know that there's other new physics, which we don't know yet, at the high energy scale, the TeV scale. And this just lists some of the problems of the standard model. It doesn't incorporate gravity. It doesn't give us a dark matter candidate. In the standard model, the forces in the early universe are not unified. And we have no idea, actually, in terms of particles and fields yet, what is dark energy. So it's a beautifully simple picture. But it leaves many questions unanswered. The structure of this theory, it's really great to be able to talk about this at Caltech. The structure of the standard model is based on quantum field theories. The first quantum field theory was quantum electrodynamics developed by Feynman, shown here lecturing at Caltech in what is now called the Feynman Lecture Hall, most appropriately. The second quantum field theory one can think about is the unified electroweak theory between the electromagnetic and weak interactions. And one of the great questions to be answered at the LHC is, what is the mechanism that drives what is called electroweak symmetry breaking? What allows within a unified theory to have a massless particle, the photon, and heavy, weak force carriers, the W and Z bosons, in one theory? And of course, the third quantum field theory, please mute for now. The third theory is quantum chromodynamics, where one of the main elements is asymptotic freedom of quarks, and that was discovered by David Politzer and others here. So the LHC. The LHC is, as most of you know, a 27-kilometer tunnel under the ground spanning the border between Switzerland and France. And at this accelerator, there are four major experiments. And our group works on CMS. And another collaboration of similar size with similar physics goals is ATLAS. So this is a picture of the LHC, which is sitting from underground, 50 to 150 meters below the ground. As I'll say in a moment, it's made tremendous progress over the last couple of years, and especially this year. And you can see on this plot here, if you look at the stored beam energy for various machines in the past, that the LHC is way beyond all of those. Eventually, it will reach a beam energy of about 300 megajoules per beam, but already it reached an energy operating at half of the particle energy at 7 TeV in, versus a design of 14 TeV. But even so, it's already reached 110 megajoules per beam. So for the public, we have various ways to express it. So that amount of energy is equivalent to 27 kilometers of Swiss chocolate.
But
kilograms. Thank you, physics students, for correcting my units. But the energy release of the Swiss chocolate is somewhat slower. Okay, and then here at the bottom, you see all the magnets sitting at 1.9 degrees Kelvin. So this summarizes various aspects of the great progress that the LHC has made. Already in 2010, the luminosity, or roughly speaking, the intensity, increased by a factor of 200,000 in 5 months. But to really get to have the physics reach we have now, there had to be additional progress, and there was, reaching another factor of 15 this year to this number for physicists, luminosity of 3.6 times 10 to the 33. And next year, the plan is to increase the luminosity by another factor of 1.5 or 2 and potentially more. Down here, I've summarized various things about the LHC where it's really exceeded already some of its design characteristics. The number of protons per bunch is greater than design. And the emittance, the spread in momentum coordinate space, has already been shown to be somewhat smaller than was expected in the design. And here also, they focus the beams more and more to reach higher and higher luminosity. On the on your right, you see in green CMS and overlaid in black is Atlas, the luminosity that was accumulated during the course of the year. The goal was an amount of luminosity, one inverse femtobarn. And that was reached actually in the first 3 months by the middle of June. And then a second goal was set, and a more ambitious goal of five inverse femtobarns, and that was also passed. So CMS has collected 5.7 inverse femtobarns, of which you'll see the data samples. Well, 5.7 was delivered, 5.2 was collected, and most of the data samples, which I'll show, are with 4.7 inverse femtobarns. So this again summarizes some of the progress in luminosity, and I already said a lot of this. The operational efficiency was about 91%. The detector's in great shape. The average subsystem has 98.5% of the channels all working. And so this is a picture of CMS. I won't have time to say much about it, but it's a very novel design, which was modular. It was originally built on the surface and then lowered down piece by piece, with the largest piece being 2,000 tons. And it has a number of exceptional technologies, which I'll say a little bit about. The first thing that comes to mind, and I won't say that much more about it, is the inner tracker that measures particle trajectories and momenta and has tremendous resolution and ability to deal with very high multiplicities. The second thing, which I'll say more about because it's crucial for some of the main channels in the Higgs search, is a crystal calorimeter which is composed of 76,000 lecton state crystals. So here you can see CMS all buttoned up. This was actually the first time it was assembled a couple of years ago. Here you can see some of the more inner parts of the detector as it was installed. Okay, so as I said, it's been an outstanding year. We have lots of luminosity. And so we have new reach for the Higgs that I'll talk about. And also for other things I won't have time to say much about, other forms of new physics such as supersymmetry. We're very happy that our group is at the heart of many of these things, both for the electromagnetic calorimeter and other parts of the detector, such as what's called the hadron calorimeter, which surrounds the electromagnetic calorimeter. Also in the trigger of the apparatus that leads to recording data after filtering the online data streams, the reconstruction to physics quantities, and the analysis. And also a lot to do with the global technical infrastructure that helps the physics community, which is particular to our group. So to say the least, this new voyage in finding new physics has just begun. So a little bit about the electromagnetic calorimeter. As I said, there are 76,000 large crystals weighing 90 tons. This detector and the study of the crystals was led by Renwan Tzu, who's here in the audience, a staff member in our group, a member of professional staff. There's a barrel with 62,000 crystals, which point towards the interaction point, and there are two end caps, which total 14,000 crystals on the two ends. It's the high resolution of the crystals and their granularity, the large number of cells, which gives us a lot of the power for some of the main channels that I'll talk about. Within the electromagnetic calorimeter community in CMS, our group is one of the strongest groups, and we've led the operation of the eCal, the detector performance, and some critical areas of calibration which are critical for the high resolution and therefore for the Higgs search. So this shows results from our crystal lab, which is here in Lauritsen. And CMS has, the crystals are made of lead tungstate, which has a high density, as shown here, a specific gravity of more than 8. And some of the other crystals that we've also developed in the crystal lab are also shown. For the future, at the high luminosity LHC, and if I have time, I'll say a little bit about it at the end, we're looking into a new type of crystal, lutetium, yttrium, orthosilicate, on the right. A fast and bright and radiation-hard scintillator. From the moment that the LHC started and CMS started operation, which was at 7 TeV, which was in March 2009, our group had some of the first results and results which are relevant in talking to Higgs search. In the first moments, we saw pi zero, neutral pions, decaying to two photons in the apparatus. And you see some of the people here, Marat, who's in the audience, Ayong and Adi are there at CERN. This is a small photograph from that evening here in Lauritsen, where some of the group was at CERN, including Maria, and some were here for those first moments of data taking. And this turned out to be quite important for the Higgs search. So our group has developed this calibration technique for the first time at a Hadron Collider. To use the copious flux of pi zero and also eta mesons, which decay into photon pairs, to track the response of the crystals and also to calibrate in the presence of radiation damage to get high precision. The technique that was developed has been successful. In the barrel, the precision is in the range of half a percent to about 1% at the end of the barrel and 2% in the end cap. So what about the Higgs? Is this the only Higgs around? We learned a lot about where the Higgs isn't. From early accelerators like LEP, the Large Electron Positron Collider, and also measurements at the Tevatron, we learned that the Higgs, if it's a standard model Higgs predicted by this guy, had to be relatively light. Also direct search, this was from other so-called precision electroweak data. Also from direct searches, we learned from LEP that it had to be greater than 114.5 GeV, and recently a narrow range was also excluded from Fermilab. Things progressed pretty rapidly. With part of the data from 2011, we already were able to exclude more of the range. From CMS, you see that from 145 GeV up, except for for some very narrow exceptions, the Higgs mass could be excluded. And in November, when CMS and ATLAS took their data, the data which they had through August, and combined it, they excluded essentially all the range from 141 to 476 GeV. So as you can see, the available range for the Higgs is getting narrower. And also, if you look at the overall electroweak results, Now, if you make a combined fit for the Higgs mass, of course, the available range is getting narrower. And also in this plot of the mass of the top quark, which you mesh, has been measured rather precisely versus the mass of the W boson, that a lot of the available range for the Higgs has been cut out by the CMS and also Atlas exclusions. The visible energy in multi-jet events, the ability to tag heavy quarks, jets from heavy quarks, so-called B quarks, which is done with both high efficiency and also good understanding for the data versus the simulation. And also the electron ID, the ability to identify electrons is very well understood. This is versus an angular variable which physicists use at hadron colliders called the pseudorapidity. In searching for the Higgs, one has to understand and filter out many standard model processes. This is a series of channels which have been very well measured on a log scale, starting from the very, at the LHC, very copious W and Z, then radiative W production together with a photon, Z and a photon, W pairs, WZ, ZZ, going down forward as a magnitude. And by this time, you reach the same level as a Higgs of 140 GeV decaying into two Zs. And you see down here, the cross-section is 1.7 inverse femtobarns. This is the amount of luminosity which was used in this analysis, 1.7 inverse femtobarns to make those measurements. Okay, so what about the first channel that comes to mind, Higgs to gamma gamma? This highlights some of the people in our group, several of our students, Yossi Ma, I already introduced Yong Yong, Jan Vaverka, and Vladlen Timchuk. I introduced Renwan, who's in the audience, Yossi Ma, and Marat, who's also in the audience. What you see here is the actual data for photon pairs as a function of mass, and you can see the background fit, the smooth background fit, through the data looking for a peak. And actually, to get the most out of this, as you'll see, we use statistical methods to get the most out of the data. Okay, so the signature is as shown here. This is a candidate event. Of course, the signal to background ratio is low. So if I look at any single event, the likelihood that it's a background is high. But this is what it would look like. Two energetic isolated photons. The background, after we do the analysis, is mainly from an irreducible reaction by which you can get two partons, namely two gluons, can fuse and produce two photons. There also are other reducible backgrounds when a quark or antiquark emits a photon, which accompanies jets in the final state. And some of the jets, one or two of the jets, can fake a photon. So the data are divided into four categories in the electromagnetic calorimeter, in the barrel region, which I mentioned, or with one photon in the end caps, whether it converts or starts to shower or not. If it doesn't start to shower in the material before the eCal, that has higher resolution, and you want to take advantage of that in the analysis. The background, which I showed you, is fitted by a polynomial. And the signal shape is well parametrized by a sum of three Gaussians. You see here, this is all categories combined. The effective resolution for 120 GeV Higgs, this is derived by looking at Z's going to E plus E minus and then projecting that resolution and the resolution function onto what we would see for a Higgs. And the overall effective resolution for all categories, good and not so good, is 1.94 GeV. As I'll mention, for the best categories, it's below 1%. One of the tremendous efforts of our group has been to intercalibrate the crystals and follow the behavior of the crystals as they change under irradiation in the LHC environment. This shows the data throughout 2011 of the crystals evolving from transparency, starting at 1 and going down in this plot by several percent. On average, the average crystal in the barrel lost 2.5%. In the end caps, 10%, and at small angles of the beam lines, considerably more. But by using our intercalibration techniques with pi zero and eta decays, and the laser, which takes a series of measurements every 40 minutes, we're able to correct this behavior, and the RMS that comes out after that analysis is a stable result to 0.14% in the barrel and 0.5% in the end cap. By studying the resulting resolution with a Z, you can see that we have in the barrel region 1 GV resolution on the Z. Some of the other work to set the energy scale precisely was done using Z decays to a muon pair and a photon. If you look at the kinematics of the final state, look at the muons, and derive the energy of the photons compared to the measurement, you can set the scale. And so by the process of doing this has an accuracy shown here, below 1% in the barrel and 1.5% in the end caps. And this is the work, first of all, for the mu-mu radiative muon pairs, Jan Wawerka and Vladlen Timchuk for the study of Z goes T plus E minus. Okay, so to select photons, a lot has been done. Looking in the ECAL and converting the clusters into energies, Yong Yong, who's there at CERN, is one of our graduate students who is leading that. Marat and Yong have done the pi zero and eta calibration. Yong, Marat, Adi Bornheim, and Renwan, the transparency corrections. And then measuring the scales I already mentioned with two of our other graduate students, resulting in improved energy resolution. You can also see the very good degree of understanding by comparing the efficiency for finding photons in the data versus the simulations, how the two match very well. And look at the ratio. There are small systematic corrections that have been made, which turn out to be quite small in this case. Well, so here are the distributions in the four categories. This is the diphoton mass spectrum in the barrel and end cap. If both photons are unconverted, and or if one, at least one starts to convert and shower. And you see superimposed what we would see for a Higgs at 120 GB. And to highlight how difficult the measurement is, you see these are the curves we would expect for 5 times the standard model. Nevertheless, if you analyze this data as a function of mass, you see that the expectation in terms of what you should be able to see, the limit of what you could see for the Higgs normalized to the standard model cross-section is about 1.5 to 2 times. So that dashed curve expresses our sensitivity at this point from this one channel. The solid curve that you see up and down is a result of a fit to the data. And you can see there are fluctuations. The green band is plus or minus 1 standard deviation. The yellow band is plus or minus 2 standard deviations. And you can see some fluctuations both up and down. And so it's very important to understand those fluctuations and their significance, or their not so great significance, before coming to any conclusion. And I'll say a lot more about that. But this, as I said, is the most sensitive channel at low mass, and what's in front of you are already a big piece of the many results that I'll show today. A lot of study has gone into the analysis. A lot of study has gone into fitting the background shape and with certain curves and asking, you know, is this a biased or not? And this physicist had some question about this. And after a long study, this is, it has a small bias. There's a small loss of sensitivity, but it's a good description of the background. Okay, so for this channel, what's the outlook for 2012? I'll say more about the results, the statistics. Other channels bring it all together shortly. But for this channel, we expect 4 times the data in 2012, probably an increase to 8 TB. We only will know this for sure in a few weeks. That would give us 4 times the data set in total and more sensitivity. Continued work on the resolution, a new laser to improve the transparency corrections with somewhat less frequent interventions on the laser system, improvements on the reconstruction study of the backgrounds, and in fact, what makes up all that background. There's a lot of study to do on all the standard model contributions to that background and higher order calculations to it, optimization of the photon identification, and improve multivariate analysis to get the most out of the data. As shown at the bottom, Marat has had a founding role on this analysis, and Adi has led the ECAL detector performance group, which is another part of the leadership of our group. Okay, so this just says more about the resolution and also points out that in the central part of the barrel, the resolution is about 1 GB for 120 GB Higgs. The next channel, where our group also has a leading role, which is most sensitive in the low mass region, is Higgs goes to a W pair, and each W goes to a lepton, an electron, and a muon, or a neutrino. What you see here is a summary of the sensitivity, the 95% confidence level limit, which is actually derived for different channels now that the analysis has been done. And if you look as a function of mass at which is the lowest curve, because which can go lowest in terms of the limit on the measured cross-section normalized to the standard model, you see here the diphoton mode we talked about, and next is the WW mode. And this curve is actually derived from the analysis of the data. Then after that, you know, Z pair goes to 4 leptons, and some of the other modes that I'll talk about. You see the crossing point for WW and a diphoton. Originally, people would think it was up here around 130 GB, but we've already reached the state in the WW analysis where it's competitive down to 120 GB. So the expectation would be that this channel alone, if with an average set of data, would be able to exclude a Higgs mass from 125 to 300 GeV. And so we'll see what the result is. So this summarizes the analysis. Here's the Feynman diagram of a W pair going to a lepton pair and 2 neutrinos. You see a graph on the right of some of the backgrounds which have to be suppressed by this analysis on a log scale. So there are large backgrounds from W boson production in association with jets. Drellion production is a standard model process which creates lepton pairs. The top quark can also produce leptons and missing energy in the final state, just like our candidate channel of WW goes to 2 leptons and neutrinos, which appear as missing energy. And then the WW itself, the standard model process, compared to the Higgs, the candidate Higgs process. So we look for 2 opposite sign leptons, E plus E minus, or mu plus mu minus, or an electron and a muon of opposite sign coming from W plus W minus. Significant missing energy from the neutrinos. There's no mass peak because there's a continuum in the neutrino energy in the W decay. There should be no heavy quark jets. We can actually distinguish those from light quark jets. No additional muon, which is an important discriminator. You can have 1 or 2 extra jets because you can also produce this through the so-called vector boson fusion process. And because the Higgs is a scalar, if we look at the angle between the lepton pair, the azimuthal angle between the two should be tend to be small. So this shows some of the main requirements to get through the discussion today. I think I won't go through the cuts in detail, but you can see that each selection is designed to remove some of the principal backgrounds, which are listed there in the upper right. And finally, at the bottom, kinematic constraints on the mass, the invariant mass of the lepton pair, and the angle tend to suppress the WW standard model background to get at the Higgs signal. This shows the flow of the selections, what we call the cuts. First, to enrich the sample of W pairs compared to anything else. And finally, to get down to try to increase the fraction of the remaining data, which could be from a Higgs. You can see that at every phase, the various standard model backgrounds in the simulation compare very well to the data, which are the black dots. This is how it would go for a Higgs of 130 GeV. The analysis is optimized for each mass point, so the flow of cuts is somewhat different for a Higgs. Another mass, there's the example of 140 GeV. Okay, so first we do this standard cut-based analysis. We make selections. At the end, as I said, they're applied to suppress WW events. If you do the analysis for 120 GeV and look at some of the principal distributions, such as the azimuthal angle between the lepton pair or the invariant mass of the lepton pair, then for the Higgs of 120 GeV, you see that there's a hint of an excess over the background. The data points, the black points, and the various backgrounds, which are now dominated by WW in the pale blue. And down here is a simulation of what a signal would appear like at 120 GeV. You can see with this data, we don't have definitive sensitivity to, you know, to say it is a Higgs or to rule it out, and I'll say more about that. At a higher mass, see here is the contribution from a possible Higgs signal. It would add on top of here, and we can already rule that out. Now, in the recent months, there's been an improved analysis using a statistical multivariate technique called boosted decision trees, which you can look up on the web. It's an optimized way of separating signal from background with a set of criteria. It's an automated learning technique. And so it uses what it sees in the data, and you can understand it very well if the data and simulations match very well, so you can see what's underneath. This is a way to get an optimized analysis. So you can see here the results of such an improved analysis. This is the output of the so-called boosted decision tree. The signal down here tends to peak towards the higher values, towards one. And you see the background again, which is dominated at the end of the analysis by the pale blue. Now, in order to further improve the analysis, the data has been broken up into categories. Zero jets in association with the lepton pair and missing energy, and one jet. As you increase the number of jets, we also have data with two jets. The background from other channels, like a Z boson plus jets in green, or top quarks, which also produce multi-jets, as well as leptons and missing energy, the relative contribution of such channels increase. And you can compare the backgrounds to the sensitivity to a signal. Here, there's a hint, again, nothing definitive, of the data slightly above the backgrounds. And you'll see how that comes out in the overall statistical analysis. The use of this machine learning technique, so-called, this multivariate analysis, which uses the lepton PTs, the mass of the lepton pair, the so-called transverse mass, and the overall topology of the dileptons and missing energy, gives you better sensitivity over the full mass range, especially at the higher masses. And you can see the results here. Because they're on different scales, I try to highlight that. This is a cut-based analysis covering the full mass range that's analyzed. This is the 95% confidence limit on the cross-section normalized to the standard model cross-section. And where the curve goes below one, that's what's excluded. You can also see the observed values from the data, which are in red, to the dash curve, which is the expectation, what you'd expect to see on average. And you can see that they match very well. So the expected exclusion for the cut-based analysis, 128 to 236. For the boosted decision tree, it's somewhat more sensitive. You can see that the range you expect to exclude is larger. But of course, we don't know yet if there's a signal or not at this point. And the observed exclusion seems to match pretty well, but you'll see that this difference is not something to be ignored. So we can exclude down to 128 GV. We expect to be able to exclude down to 125 GV just from this channel. Next, we come to the so-called golden channels. Why golden? Well, you produce four leptons, and often there isn't that much else activity. And in fact, this is a so-called typical event. This is our first event. It came very, very early compared to expectations. It has a four lepton mass, an overall invariant mass of 201 GeV. And you can see the four muons over here. This shows the selection on the PT of the leptons. We try to keep this loose to get the most we can out of this. So for one Z, we have these PT cuts, and also on the other Z, we have a very loose window around the Z mass. Okay, so this tells how we can get at normalizing the background rate and separating it out. The rate, predicting the rate, comes from looking at Zs and using the theoretical cross-section ratio for two Zs to one Z, because we don't have such a large sample of Z pairs yet. Okay, so from this selection, this shows the results over the full mass range. You see the main backgrounds are ZZ and Z plus jets up there compared to the data. What you see superimposed, which may be a little bit confusing, is what a Higgs signal would look like. This is not amplified. This is what it would look like one times expectation at different Higgs masses. And if you look carefully, you see, wonder if there's something down there, but there are very few events. Overall, the number of observed events is 72, and the expected number of events is 67. That in itself is consistent within statistics. You can also look at the breakdown between the different types of leptons. So E plus E minus, E plus E minus, four, so-called 4E. We observe 12 and expect 14. Four muons, we observe 23 and we expect 20. And two electrons, E plus E minus and mu plus E minus, we see 37 and we expect 33. Then if you zoom in on the low mass region and look in more detail, well, first of all, the number of events is no strong indication. The observed number of events is 13 in this plot in the low mass region from 100 to 160 GeV. And the expected events is 9.5. And these are the different types, classes of events that we have for this channel. One thing that's interesting, and it can, you know, we'll see later if it's just a fluctuation. This is a high resolution channel, and there are three events at 119.5 GeV. You see for the individual events in this bin, the central values and the errors. And over here, around 123.5, there are two events which are also close by. But these are just, you know, handfuls of events. So it's just something to keep in mind. Okay, so now we'll move on to some other channels which are also related to Higgs to ZZ. In this case, two leptons and missing energy. One thing that we do to separate out the usual background is if it comes from a massive particle, this is for the high mass Higgs, then the Zs will be boosted. So we can estimate the Z plus jets background from the data, where you can sort of fake the signal. And this shows some of the distributions, some of the major backgrounds, and how we suppress them by requiring missing transverse energy, for example. For the low statistics standard model backgrounds, we have to use simulations to estimate the background from ZZ and also WZ. So this is the result for this channel. You can see some of the distributions. This is the transverse mass distribution for the data. This is the cut-based analysis and also an analysis which uses the shape of the transverse mass, which is slightly more sensitive. And the result which comes out of this shape analysis is an exclusion from 270 to 440 GeV. So moving on, the highest mass, highest rate channel where the Higgs could go to two Zs would be two leptons and two, it says 2Q for two quarks, means that you see two jets. And so here's a candidate event where you can see the very nice two electrons, actually plus and minus, and then two jets. And the mass of the whole system is 580 GeV. This is a channel to look for a high mass Higgs. Some of the things which I use to select are, if you look at the kinematics of the final state, you have two production angles and three independent decay angles. These five angles can be used to make a kinematic discriminant, a likelihood discriminator, which is shown here. And you can see the data, the black points. The leading background is a Z boson in association with jets. And the red histogram here is what a signal would look like. But you have to pay attention. This is 100 times the signal. And also, we're able to use the discrimination between gluon jets and quark jets, because here you get the second Z from a quark and an antiquark. And so gluon jets should not participate in this channel. And that's a useful discriminator. In the end, here's the results. Oh, yes, we also categorize the events in different numbers of heavy quark jets, 0, 1, or 2. And this provides useful additional discrimination power. In the low mass range, and there's a separate selection for the high mass range. And then here you see the limits. Again, this is the cross section, the maximum cross section at 95% confidence level, normalized to the standard model cross section. You can see that here it comes down at this mass at between 155 and 160. You have the greatest sensitivity, and the data is a bit below the expectation. And here it extends out the high mass. Okay. Next is two Zs going to two leptons and two taus. Taus are heavy leptons. And the tau can decay hadronically, plus a neutrino, or an electron and neutrinos, or a muon and neutrinos. And so, for example, here's a candidate where you see three electrons, so-called, seen in the electromagnetic calorimeter. A candidate to come from a tau, because there's missing energy also. And then the other hadronic, you see a jet. And here you see the data. There are just a few events. The main backgrounds are a Z pair going to a lepton pair and a tau pair from a standard model process. And here you see the limits, at best several times the standard model. But like I said, oh yes, 10 events observed and 10.3 expected. Like I said, every channel has its own contribution to the overall sensitivity. Next is back to the low mass. The Higgs just goes to a tau pair, a very distinctive signature. Here's a candidate event where you can see clearly a tau going to pi plus and a pi zero and missing energy. So you can produce the Higgs through the gluon fusion, through a top quark loop. Or you can have the system boosted by an additional jet. This shows a gluon jet being radiated, boosting the rest of the system, boosting the Higgs, or the vector boson fusion process. And there are different selections for each one. The boosted mode has been added since the last major conference in August. The most sensitive mode is the vector boson fusion, because you have these two forward jets with a large angle, large pseudorapidity interval between them. This is the data for different channels, different tau decay modes, comparing the data in black points to the various backgrounds. And then if you look at the ratio of the data to the predictions, you see it's pretty much consistent with large error bars. And then here is the result on the limit, the observed limit, the black points. And again, the expected limit is the red line. The yellow is plus minus one sigma band, and the green is plus minus two sigma band. And you see, again, what doesn't look like very significant, but a tendency for the observation to be above the expectation. Not significant by itself, but we're going to put all this together. And finally, the low-mass Higgs search, the most difficult channel, is the Higgs going to two bottom quarks. When people think about this channel, the first thing they think is that this is just jets in the final state, so the background should be overwhelming. But there is one option which is useful, which is to have this associated production of a vector boson, a W or a Z, in association with the Higgs candidate, which goes to two jets. You can use a topology where the azimuthal angle between the vector boson and the Higgs candidate, again, the two-jet system, is nearly back-to-back, and make other cuts, kinematic cuts, tight B-tagging cut, and also on the missing energy. And there are five sub-channels which are studied, depending upon whether you have a W goes to a lepton and a neutrino, or a Z to two leptons, or just missing energy from the Z going to a pair of neutrinos. And this is the data compared to the expectations. You can see down here the ratio fits well. And then the results. This is the result of an analysis which mainly uses the mass of the two jets. And this is, again, an improved boosted decision tree analysis. So now we put things together. Well, eight channels. I won't say much about statistics. This is a likelihood ratio where basically you're testing whether the data favor a signal plus a background, in this case the Higgs signal at different masses from all these different channels, versus background only. A likelihood test means that given the data, what is the most likely model? One of the difficult points, apart from testing the signal versus background hypothesis as an alternative to the background-only hypothesis, is how you handle systematics. There are many systematic errors. There are many other quantities which can vary apart from what you're interested in, most of all the Higgs mass. And so you have to represent this and know how to sample the likelihood distributions. Now, this takes many thousands of hours of computing time. For people who are interested, this is a reference to the note about the procedures that the LHC collaborations have agreed upon. They agreed to do this in time for the summer conferences. Okay. So you remember our projections. This is the results of all our data. Here over the full mass range, and you can see the various channels and how they contribute. What you're looking at here is the 95% limit on the cross-section that we measured compared to the standard model cross-section. Again, when it goes below 1, for any given channel, we can exclude the standard model Higgs over that mass range. And you look again at the various channels. Here's gamma-gamma from our data. Here's Z to 4 leptons, which just above the range where gamma-gamma is most sensitive becomes the most sensitive, but except, as I said, except for WW. And the various other channels I talked about. Here's the low-mass range again. This is actually the results of our data. I actually showed you this before. And here's the combined limit. Okay. Now, this is what you would expect for all of our data from the analysis. You'd expect to be able to exclude down to about 117 GeV, but that's the analysis about what does the actual data say, and we'll come back to that plot. So first of all, this is the combined result of the search. What we do here is we have this quantity, which we call CLS for people in the field. What it means is it allows you to to rule out cross sections which are any bigger than what's shown. In other words, this is the 95% confidence level limit, and here's the this is at the 95% confidence level. This is 99% confidence level. And what we can see here, we can exclude a 95% confidence limit from 127. I guess it's easier to see over here in the low mass range. Here's our data. And so at 197 GV, we go below the line which represents the 95% confidence level limit. It's a very sharp limit. We very quickly go down below the 99% confidence level limit. So what was expected, as I showed you, was 117 GV to 543 GV, 95% confidence limit. What we can actually exclude is 127 to 600 GV. And so you can see here there's some deviation in the data, which doesn't allow us to exclude a Higgs below 127 GV. As I mentioned, the 99% confidence level limit, we can exclude 128. What we expect to be able to exclude if there were nothing there would be 125. Okay. So this shows it again. This is the 95% confidence level limit on the ratio of the cross sections, and where the data crosses one gives you the limit. And the dashed line is what you expect. So the fact that the data is above the dashed line shows that there's some localized excess. Okay. This is the p-value. It's the probability. What it means is the probability that you have background only. And you see, you remember the three events, the four muons? That causes this at 119.5 GV. There also is from the Higgs, this is a Higgs to gamma gamma. So this also has a dip down here around 119 GV, and also one at about 124 GV. In order to interpret this, when you have a high resolution, you have to think about the mass interval that you're looking in. And what is the chance that since you're looking in so many bins that you see some fluctuation? So the local significance of this is about 2.3 standard deviations for the most pronounced peak. You see here is 2 sigma, here is 3 sigma. But the trial factor, the number of effective bins, is about 20. So if you think about the significance of seeing such a fluctuation, if it's a fluctuation in the whole mass range, this mass range here, the global significance is only about 0.8 standard deviations, which is not significant. Another thing you can do is you can test what is the strength of a signal that I have to add, what is the best fit, looking at my data in this channel, to fit this data, how much signal do I have to add? And how does it compare to the standard model cross-section? And you can see here that in this region, remember we have two, because of the nature of our data, we have two things here, that the strength of the signal is compatible with one over this range. Again, it's not a doesn't rule out background only, but it's some kind of indication, and it's being combined with other channels. This is the result from Higgs to ZZ to 4 leptons. We expect to exclude from 130 GV to 160, and then 182 to 420, and we get an observed exclusion, which is somewhat similar. Other channels have also ruled out this range already, but it's a contribution. If you look down here, look at the tendencies, because we're combining so many channels, you can see that the limit that we get is somewhat above the expectation, which is a hint of a small excess. These are all the channels together. This is the 95% confidence level limit. Wherever you see some of these channels go below one, that's the region that's excluded. You can see this light blue, the Higgs to gamma gamma. The dashed lines are the expectation. The actual data is these wiggles, because this is very, essentially, we're dealing with small fluctuations on the background. You can see the dark blue is Higgs to WW, the red Higgs to ZZ, and then the combined, the solid black is the combined, and the black dash curve is the expectation. And over here is the low mass range. So if we look at the low mass region and compare the data to expectations, then you see a couple of things, that not only one channel is contributing, but many channels are contributing. You see, first, for the low-resolution channels, like the WW, where because of the missing energy, you don't have really high mass resolution at all, you see a broad hint of an excess. In the high-resolution channels, such as the gamma-gamma and the four leptons, where the resolution goes from 1 to 2.7%, you see that because of the high resolution, you see these structures. So you're able to resolve them. But the point is that overall, putting them together, you see a broad excess and some modulation from the high-resolution channels. And because of the modest excess of events, we cannot exclude the region between 115 and 127 GeV.
We don't see the two peaks anymore, 119
and 120. Yeah, well, when you combine everything in a sort of overall likelihood fit, some have attention with respect to the other, and so this is the outcome.
So the last plot is actually all the modes?
These are the high-resolution modes. So this is four leptons and gamma-gamma. And remember, this is the limit. Okay, so the limit moves up because there's some small excess of events. The other one was the p-value, which is the probability that the data can be described by the background only, and that tends to give these negative peaks. Okay, so these are the p-values, what you just asked about. Here's the whole mass range, and here are the two peaks. This comes from gamma-gamma. If you look carefully, you see the dashed line is the gamma-gamma contribution. The black is overall. It's dominated by the gamma-gamma. This, you see the red and the black are superimposed. This comes from the 3-4 muon events. And then here you see it on a bigger scale. You see the two peaks are actually quite close to each other. The maximum local significance is down here, is 2.6 sigma. If you consider the whole mass range, which I don't think is really appropriate because all of this has been long ago excluded up here, you'd get only 0.6 sigma. But if you focus on the low mass range, which has not previously been excluded, it's still 1.9 sigma. That's the global p-value. It is, looking in all the relevant channels, what's the significance of this? It's 1.9 sigma, which means that in a one-sided limit, this is sort of 2.5% probable. So the excess has a modest statistical significance, and it could still be compatible with a fluctuation of the background. Okay. Well, an important thing to do is to compare these things to what you'd expect from a standard model Higgs. You could see the maximum local significance we saw is 2.6 sigma. If we had a Higgs with a standard model cross-section and look at 124 GeV, then you find that you'd expect 2.9 sigma. So like I showed in other plots, the strength of a candidate signal which is not yet established is consistent with a standard model cross-section. This is another way of doing it. I think I already, this is for the strength of the signal again. So, and it touches one around the 124 GV. Now, what's the composition of the excess? Where does it come from? And I had hinted at this and sort of led you through some of the things of the individual channels. This is on a graph. The best fit sigma normalized to the standard model cross-section. Focusing on the places where you have the greatest local significance, you can see that with large error bars, each of the channels are compatible with the best fit, which is 1. And at 124, you can see that there's also clustering of the different channels around 1, but again, with big error bars. So this is getting to be about the most you can say at this point. It's intriguing. So the really solid result, of course, is we've now narrowed the exclusion range tremendously over the last months and also in what we're showing today. And this shows, this is a famous plot for physicists, especially for high-energy physicists, to look from all the data, what's the available range for the mass of the Higgs, and we watch this excluded region, which is in yellow, close in. And so this is where we are now. If you look at the mass of W versus the mass of the top, you have many measurements. First, going back to the previous generation accelerator LEP, and also the first run of the Tevatron, and then more recently, direct searches at the Tevatron, which gave us this narrow ellipse, and earlier from LEP, and also experiments at SLAC, an experiment at SLAC, it sort of shrunk down. And then also, the recent CMS limits sort of have wiped all this out. So what remains is focusing on that region if the Higgs is there. Okay, so conclusion about the Higgs, taken about 1 hour so far. We've been able to very rapidly analyze our data. I think that's great. I think it's different from previous generation of experiments, even though the environment and the experiment is much more complex than previous experiments. But I have to also emphasize that these results are preliminary. We have additional work to do. The analysis continues to be improved, and the publications will be at the end of January. And we're looking for improvements until then. We're also looking at certain other channels which may add to this picture. But whatever we do, we won't be able to really definitively establish the Higgs. It's very unlikely that we'll be able to rule it out in this mass range between 115 and 127 GV, in which you have essentially 5 independent channels with significant contributions to that effect. As I mentioned, the maximum local significance is 2.6 sigma, taking into account the look elsewhere effect. The global significance is 1.9 sigma. So what we have is consistent either with a background fluctuation or with the existence of a Higgs boson in that mass range. More data in 2012 will be needed to draw a conclusion. Well, so I want to remind you what the science is. We're here to understand what the nature of electroweak symmetry breaking is. If nature matched our simplest, most primitive ideas, that would be fine. That would also leave a lot of other questions unanswered, which I also showed you earlier. If we don't have a Higgs of the standard model cross-section, there are ways in which Mark is one guy who has published a paper on the subject. There are escape clauses in which the cross-section could be lower, and so we have to continue to look. There are other alternatives to the standard model which are much more compelling, such as supersymmetry, and we also hope that we'll soon find other exotic forms of new physics. So that's my status report on the Higgs. Now, if you stay with me for a few moments. So first of all, there's a public document. This is the note CMS you can find on the web about the combination of all the channels. And the conclusion, as I told you, is at the low end of the explored range, the observed limits are weaker than the expected ones, and to ascertain the origin of the excess, we need more data. And so I'd like to thank some of the young people in our group, some of whom I mentioned today are students and are young postdocs who really made this all possible. And I also like to point out that we do a lot on the experiment. And so here are three of our students. This is, for us, one of the greatest things that happened this year, apart from the search for the that three of our students, there are 170 institutions in CMS, there are seven student awards, and three of our students got three of the seven awards. I talked a lot about the calibration of the ECAL. The trigger, we wouldn't be taking a lot of these data if it wasn't for, this is Yong Yang, if it wasn't for Alex Mott, we wouldn't be taking a lot of this data. He's really the, one of the central people on the trigger. And this is Yi Chen, who's helped suppress the noise in the HCAL, understanding the hadron calorimeter, and all those channels with jets wouldn't be as clean or with good resolution as they are if it weren't for these three students. There are other students who've done tremendous work in search for TEV resonances. This is Vladlen Timchuk. This is Piotr Trocik, who's a postdoctoral fellow, setting new limits on partners of heavier Zs. And I can't end without mentioning a huge program, which is perhaps more exciting than any of this, which is the search for supersymmetry or other new physics, which is a massive program with innovative methods developed by Maria Spiropoulou. So this is discovery physics happening. What we saw today is the tip of the iceberg. There's a lot of other exotic new physics we hope to discover in the coming years. And you can find many more CMS physics results at this place on the web, which are public. And so this is the dawn of an era. And what can I say? So we've kind of left the shore of what's known. And in the end, it's always the same. Energy, like higher energy, and persistence will conquer all things. OK. So I wanted to tell you a little bit about 2012. We hope to go to higher energy. As you go to higher energy, you can focus the beams a bit better. In this parameter, beta star, we operated at 1 meter. The luminosity goes like 1 over beta star. And they expect to reach conservatively 0.7 to 0.8. And also, by increasing the energy, it turns out that you can focus better. And you also gain a factor of gamma, the Lorentz factor. So we can expect 30% higher luminosity just from that if we go to 8 TeV. In terms of the Higgs, there's an advantage of about 20% in the cross-section for the Higgs and the mass ranges we talked about. This is the cross-section ratio of 8 TeV over 7 TeV. But for higher mass searches, this is even more important. For a 1 TeV resonance, you get a gain of a factor of 1.5. And for 2 TeV, a factor of 2, which is great. So what's going to happen in the longer term? This is a profile which was foreseen for the LHC over the long term, going out to 2030. In 2010, the goal was here, down at about 0.06 inverse femtobars. I just talked about 5. We got 0.036. The goal for these 2 years was 1 inverse femtobarn and then a shutdown, but we already have 5 inverse femtobarns. The goal is now up here for next year. So we're very much at the start. This is a log scale. But like Rolf Hoyer said this morning, we're ahead of schedule in that sense. For the future, Renmon's studying new crystals for a high luminosity LHC to survive in a very high radiation environment in the forward direction. This is actually related to crystals which were first introduced to us by Tom Tombrello, but with the addition of the Y, yttrium. So this is the physics sweep. We're down here. We're actually doing better. So the luminosity has gone up, and our search for the Higgs is advancing. It goes backward in time because we're able to do more quickly. The next thing that will happen is after this run, we'll have a year shutdown, nearly 2 years, actually. to prepare for the full energy and then run for 3 years at or close to the design energy, then have a shutdown for a major detector upgrade in 2018, then finish the regular LHC program by about 2021 or 2022. A high luminosity LHC will have about a factor of 15 greater luminosity than we discussed until now. Then the high luminosity LHC is foreseen to go to 2030. So now we're talking about the next generation. And then for the really next generation is the high energy LHC. This is very important. So to really explore the new landscape, there's a plan being discussed to have a high energy LHC. Magnets with 16 Tesla magnetic field, which is 160 kilogauss, using superconducting niobium tin, are being tested and developed with the US together with a consortium in Europe. And the idea is to combine conventional superconductors with the new high temperature superconductors as an insert to reach a field of 20 Tesla to allow an energy of 33 TeV. And this shows the progress towards such a magnet. At that time, around 2030 to 33, a lot of the accelerator complex at CERN will be improved. The injector, so-called superproton synchrotron, will be upgraded, and the main ring with the new magnets and detectors will be foreseen to be upgraded to explore the new energy region. And so that's all for today. Thank you. Question?
Word about Atlas?
All right, so there were two seminars this morning, 5 a.m. our time. This is some results from Atlas. Again, these are the p-values which they see in the whole mass range. This is in the low mass range. And you can see there in the Higgs, this is the ZZ, the four lepton channel. There's something there, somewhat above 120 GeV. Here you can see what the most significant p-value is, 125 GeV. A local p-value, 1.8%, 2.1 sigma. A standard model Higgs would give 1.4 sigma. Putting all the channels together, then their exclusion, they also went ahead and excluded something down at the bottom, which slightly extended the exclusion already seen, and they can start to exclude at 131 GeV. Expected if there was no signal would be 124.6, so there's some excess there. And like with CMS, the limits, once you get going in terms of the limits, the cutoff is very sharp. So from 95 to 99%, the lower limit that you can cut off is not very different. All right, that just shows the regions which you're excluding. The most significant p-value, 1.9 times 10 to the minus 4. For CMS, equivalently, it was about 10 to the minus 3. The local significance is 3.6 sigma, contributed by from various channels, Higgs to gamma gamma, Higgs to 4 lepton, and Higgs to WW. And with the look elsewhere effect, the global p-value, they say, is 2.5 sigma over the low mass range, or if you choose to calculate the look elsewhere effect over the whole mass range, 2.2 sigma. And this is the compatibility of the observation with the expected strength of a standard model signal. And so you see there are these indications at 125 GeV. Okay. And like us, like we experimental physicists in CMS, they too look forward to a lot more data in 2012 to see if they can resolve this question. Next question. Lisa.
So I guess I'd like to understand the gamma move better. It seems that at this, so Fabiola in her talk spent a long time talking about vertex reconstruction and Hyla. And
yes.
You haven't talked as much about that, and I'm wondering if that.
I decided to skip that. No.
They had a stronger. I thought that the gamma resolution should have been a lot better in your experiment.
Okay. So what is the situation with our, first of all, the vertex reconstruction, which I didn't show because of lack of time. So we have something like 83% reconstruction efficiency within one centimeter. And so it doesn't really contribute to the resolution. What is the situation with the resolution? So using the techniques that I described, wherever there's not a lot of material, we're doing about as well as we expected. Near the end of the barrel where there's more material, and in the end caps where there's also a lot of material, we haven't been able to untangle some effects. And so our resolution is not as high as we would like to have. And so a lot of the work will be into understanding these yet to be understood effects. So dealing with the radiation effects, the amount of material in front, and so on. We haven't yet, in spite of a lot of effort, to untangle that. But you know, we're convinced that ultimately we will understand that and have a good improvement. There are two things to be said about our present resolution. First of all, if I understand correctly, their full width maximum for all categories is 4 GeV. Ours is 3.5. In our analysis, we give there's a heavy weight which is used to events with good resolution. And as I mentioned very quickly, in the region in the barrel near 90 degrees, where there's not too much material, then we've already got a resolution of about
0.85%. So do you think the fact that they had a stronger gamma was really just luck, that they had a stronger gamma?
Luck. I think the proper answer for me is, what does luck have to do with?
Well, no, but there's a question there, which is, if it is performing optimally, I just thought that gamma should have been a stronger signal.
You have to compare the expected. What I understand is, actually went over this. Lisa's question is, she would have expected a stronger indication, given that there's an input, a nature-created input, right? Lisa would have expected CMS to have a stronger indication than ATLAS. Ryan already gave part of the correct answer, which is compare the expectations. We can't control fluctuations, whatever they are, but you can always compare the expectation. So the expectation in ATLAS is 2.4 sigma, and then CMS is 2.9 sigma. And that's the answer. Yes.
I was curious, one of the early plots when you were plotting gamma, you had the number of events when one photon converts.
Yes.
And then with no conversions. And I was kind of surprised that the converts were almost as large. The amount where one converts were almost as large as the other.
Yeah, it's a function of the conversion length and also the angular region, which is covered by, relatively speaking, a lot of material.
So it's very low mass pairs that are.
Well, the point is, you just have a certain number of radiation lengths or conversion lengths.
Oh, okay. So just probability gets much larger because you have a lot of.
So the tracker, apart from the central part of the barrel, has relatively a lot of material. Okay. Lisa.
So when you have increased amount, how will pileup be an issue?
Pileup so far is not a big issue. We're able to, to sort it out and correct for it, and we see it's not a very big effect. This is actually CMS is overall a very granular detector. And so the amount of energy which is overlaid on the crystals is not very large.
So even next year, you don't expect it?
Well, I think, we had an average number of pileup events, which was about 12, and up to somewhere around 25, we're in pretty good shape. And after that, I think we have to analyze how to deal with more than that.
Okay.
Yeah,
what sort of width improvement can you imagine?
Well, I would say, you know, in certain angular regions, it's substantial. So, for example, in the NCAP, there really is a 3% effect we don't understand. So, you know, for certain angular regions, it might be a factor of 1.5 improvement if we finish our investigation.
But what fraction of the events goes there?
Well, you know, it's some, I don't remember the exact number, it's some tens of percent, but the point is, a more to the point question is, what is the weight in the overall likelihood fit? If the NCAPs were perfect, they would have a weight of 19%. At the moment, they have, all of these regions have a weight of 5%.
I think we should thank Harvey again for a great talk.